So I thought, we thought it'd be good to just jump back a little bit and take a little context and history. So this is a hand drawing, obviously. It's a PDF of a hand drawing in Bluebeam. But the information you get in a PDF or a hand drawing is right what you see. It's the floor plans, the elevations, the sections, it's dimension strings, it's notations, it's symbols. Everything you would need to understand how to build a building is in that construction document set or in that specification. And this is how it's obviously been done for years. All the information is right there for you to estimate from. And of course, you can take this then into an on-screen takeoff or anything like that, or as we go into the history of estimating to try and figure out the cost of a building. From there, move into AutoCAD, of course. Again, this is just another hand drawing in a way. It's just done in a digital format. You can gain a little bit more information, obviously, if you have access to that CAD file in the model view, as opposed from the paper space. You can click on lines and things and see their length. And the output in a PDF might be more of a vector PDF with a high snap things in on-screen takeoff program. So it's giving you a little bit more ability to increase your in an estimating platform, but really this, the CAD platform is mainly for the designer to have more efficiency in the way they do it. So we'll jump now to BIM, Building Information Modeling, and a Revit model. So again, this is, the output is a PDF, it's kind of a static PDF from this 3D model. And I always say this too, the architect spends months, even years, working in a 3D environment, and the output to us as contractors are 2D plans, elevations, and sections. So we have to spend, you know, days and weeks trying to rebuild this building oftentimes in our head when the architect has had access to this 3D environment, even building, you know, physical chipboard models and things like that to understand the space, cutting sections through the model. So if we have access to that 3D model, just as a visualization, it just helps us understand how that document went together. Of course, in a 3D model, you can click on any surface, in this case, kind of a wall panel of a building, and that's links, you know, parametrically to the plan view, to the elevation, to the schedule. So just a way of understanding the building gives you a much more comprehensive look. So here you're looking at that wall system in 3D, you're looking at it in an elevation or a partial elevation, you're looking at it in plan view, and you're looking at it in the wall schedule telling you that it is, say it's 9,000 square feet of stone wall panel. So this is where we are now, where we're going to take it into how we get this information out of the architects and design teams modeling. And into a way of understanding and driving kind of a more comprehensive estimate. One more thing too, the way we all draw it out too, it's in parts and pieces, it's not necessarily dumb lines that represent a T in a system. It's a way of just changing that T, in this case, from 3x3x3 to 10x10x5 and placing that on a section of pipe. So you now have quantities you can take off just in terms of not just building elements, but mechanical, electrical, plumbing elements. So now you know you have, you know, 45 of these in this mechanical room, as opposed to trying to go through and count them. And again, that door, it is linked throughout the model. It is a door that is live and connected to the plan, the elevation, the 3D, the schedule, and all that information is linked together. So now we're going to take a little history here through kind of estimating technology.
So if you're as old as I am and probably experienced the old plan takeoff, just highlighters, you know, get out the old scale, get down and measuring everything on the plans. That was kind of what I started with.
And we still do that today too.
To an extent, yes. Obviously, and then putting it into, you know, your data bank or your data sheets and formulating your estimates that way, you know, doing the handheld calculators. And then eventually kind of move on to a little bit of, you know, using the digitizer pads, where you place down your sheets on top of a digitizer and kind of did your takeoff manually again, but it was input into a computer system. Where we're at kind of now is this is using Symbol, which is a 3D modeling or BIM program that allows us to import a Revit file into it. And then, as you see here, you get the similar to how you see it in Revit, you get the whole floor plan as well as the sheet views. On the right hand side, it gives you the quantities that are imported from the Revit model, and then the categories and the quantities on the left hand side there. The output, this one is from the digitizer pad, so just the evolution of how the output is progressing through the years. And then, obviously, we did this is an OST output where we're, you know, quantities that were taken off. It gives you the height, you know, the lineal foot, square footages, whatever quantities or units of measure you put into it. And then here's kind of an output from an assembled model. We were able to isolate certain items and then, you know, it categorizes them by the properties that are in the model. So you're not so much guessing anymore on the earlier stages. You've actually got what was designed into it, and you're allowed to, you know, quantify everything.
We're gonna jump to another video too, but I wanted to touch on this one because it kind of puts the whole process together of that kind of design evolution and estimating evolution into what I was saying about having access to that 3D model that the design team has started. So you're color coding everything you're taking off. You've got tables and things telling you how much of this limestone that's in the model. You can isolate that, obviously, to try and figure out where that exists. You're still going back and forth, though, and cross-referencing that against the construction document package. The thing, too, that I said earlier is that design teams are working in that model for months before they're really getting to create some of that detail, especially the details, but even some of the sections and elevations and things that you might need to estimate early on in a project. If you have access to that model, you can use it as a communication tool then too, to make inferences and references to things that haven't been drawn yet necessarily. So in those meetings, maybe you're saying you haven't drawn this elevation yet, but I can see it's going to be brick. Is that correct? And yes, that is what we're intending, and so you can make assumptions already on things that haven't been drawn yet. And this is an evolution then from where we were estimating in a kind of Autodesk Navisworks environment, and then have since moved over to the Assemble engine, which Ashley is going to demonstrate here.
What was that Autodesk program in the last shot?
That was Navisworks, which is what, you know, a lot of general contractors use for the clash detection. It's the big heavy hitter. You can also tie the schedule to the model, and then there's a quantification tool within that. And we use that for, you know, kind of a year kind of developing that.
Can you throw your own section cuts in there if they're not already there? Can you?
That thing I was showing too, kind of had that slider of a section cut too. You can add to the model too. You could add your own section cuts. You could look at those in orthographic perspective. That section cut hasn't been made. There is, you know, there's always a this sharing economy that we're all in, whether it's, you know, ride share or whatever. There's a give and take with the design team and the contractors to make sure that, you know, that model is not a contract document. It usually comes with electronic release and says you can't trust this model. But the wealth of information you get from that to be able to cut your own sections and understand the building, if that section hasn't been drawn,
right,
is pretty valuable.
So this is kind of a, you know, demonstration of using the Assemble project or product. Here's very similar to what the Navisworks does, as well as within the Revit model. You can select different parts of the building in the actual model view, and then it shows up below. You can either select them in the model view or even in the sheet view, and you can do a comparison of the two different, you know, kind of gives you the lay of the land, showing you where everything is. Here we're also going through and kind of categorizing everything so we can put it into however we want to put it into our, or categorize it how we want to put it into our estimating software. You know, zone or area to live in a corn shell building versus a site item. And then the bid item, this is our codes that we use for O3.P, it's a tilt wall panel. And then our cost code that we can assign to it. That way when we export it into, we can go ahead and plug it into our estimating software and it's already categorized correctly. You can adjust the unit that you wanted to measure by. And then it kind of isolates that item on the left-hand side. You can go in and click it, it's already labeled. Here I'm going to go through then, I'm going to select all similar wall types that are the tilt wall panels as well. A little slower, I talked a little bit faster than I actually were.
Well, I can add in here then too, that what Ashley is saying is that, you know, the architects all design differently and they label stuff differently as well. So that, the inputs that Ashley was putting in over at this site kind of match our estimating systems too. So we're still putting in our own kind of coded symbols for how we label tilt-up wall panels, how we, you know, our cost information that's in our own company history and things like that, to add layers of information and data on top of this model that we've got. So we're essentially adding more information to this BIM as we go through the project.
And it's more customized for our use as a contractor. Here I'm continuing the categorization, adding these all to that category that was created earlier, and eventually I will isolate those.
You want to remove the knobs, didn't you?
I did. So once this is done, then we'll kind of isolate these document or these items to where we're only showing the exterior wall panels, and then it provides us an overall quantity for everything. You can adjust your visibility settings by creating rules, so I'm only here just showing anything that's a bid item or cost option or cost code with the O3.P, and then it hides everything else in the model. At this point, then, I believe I go into, category. You can color code it as well because there are several different types of tilt wall panel here. Some are furred out on the inside, some are sandwich panels, some are even fluted. So we'll go into here and you will color them by property. How they're labeled in the Revit model is by family and type. So then you can see on the model actually which ones relate to each color, and then it gives you a quantity of each type because the cost obviously is going to differ from each one. A way we can utilize this in subcontractor or trade partner negotiations is then we'll go ahead and save this as a simple view, where when we bring this model back up, we can select this view and it's already set up this way, set up these parameters. And then we're able to go ahead and, we can even take a snapshot of this. So we'll go here, we'll take a small picture of it, we can save this. Share this with our trade partners as well as export the quantities. So I'm going to save this image. I just go to my desktop. You can save it wherever you want, obviously. And then I'll export the quantities, and then you'll see kind of what we saw earlier on the the takeoff. It opens it up in Excel. Now everything is broken down by the specific wall types and individual quantities. You can adjust whichever parameters you want to see on that as well.
You might have said later, but Scott says it too, is that we're really after just numbers too. It's still Ashley's job as a seasoned estimator to trying to figure out what those numbers actually mean in terms of cost and construction.
Right.
I think that's it. One of the other things to note there too, we're going to get into it later, is that again, this is not a contract document, so you can't trust this model. It's easy just to look at those outputs of square footages and say, well, yeah, there's 10,000 square feet of concrete in the building. We're done. We've got the estimate, but you still have to do the page flip and apply apply your estimating, you know, industry knowledge and see if the model's even lying to you. That's why you're always isolating, hiding stuff, looking behind stuff. Because I did mention this earlier, that I'm a licensed architect. A lot of BIM and BDC specialists come from that world. And I've cheated the model all the time because the output is not the model. The output is the 2D contract document. So if it's easier to draw some sloping, curving ceiling as a floor because I can manipulate the model that better and then it shows in the drawing, I might do that. It may not be the best modeling practice, and we're getting to an industry where as contractors and design teams work together more often, we're modeling so that a contractor can then take that proper estimate off. But you really have to be asking your design team questions, asking us questions if we've gotten the model, if you're a trade partner, and knowing that that model can lie to you. And we're going to get into some of that.
Yeah, we'll get into a little bit later. And to speak to the point about the kind of lines you heard, the shortcuts, worked on a project where they labeled every flat surface a roof. Well, I knew I didn't have 100,000 square foot roof on a 10,000 square foot building. I mean, it was floors, ceilings, roof, everything was labeled roof. So you have to do the investigation.
And that's where Ashley's putting his knowledge into the building and saying, all right, well, the architect has that label as a family type as a roof, but I know this is a
ceiling, a 2x4 ceiling or something like that. So that's where we categorize it and we rename things. So part of the needs that were driving this is basically we're trying to improve our estimator efficiency. You know, everyone's got a tight deadline now, and it seems like everything is going faster and faster. So trying to identify and track these drivers as well remain better. And then avoid the tedious takeoff. As well as improve our value engineering change order discussions and everything. So these are just some of the needs that are driving this. Obviously, like I mentioned, some of the challenges we are the tight deadlines, the takeoff, incomplete models, or the 2D drawings even, and then trying to drive successful value engineering in a very competitive market. Some of the uses for this, obviously, are the quantity harvesting, which we talk about a lot, is you're gathering quantities from the architect's model, and then evaluating that system and scope. And we're helping them at that point do some constructability reviews as well, make sure things are going to work out the way they intend. And then you're customizing the design team's items to fit within our standards. We use Timberline as a company, so that's what I was using. And then the base all bid item, cost code, bid package, etc. That's how we categorize our items when we're assembling a full estimate. And then the ability to dial into specific scopes individually, so we can look into different types of ceilings or different types of wall types and make sure that we're evaluating or pricing the correct items. Trade partner budgeting is a big one. I've used this several times. I'll export some of the quantity information into an Excel spreadsheet, as I was showing in the video, and then kind of sharing those. We're doing a quick update before we get a model on the architect one. If we're staying on track, so we're looking for quick turnaround. I know you guys are busy, or the trade partners are busy as we are, so if I can provide that information to you, I will. And then we can apply either a unit cost to that or something and cover ourselves. And then the color-coded visual representation and just allows for really quick turnaround sometimes. The cost design progression analysis, so this is something I didn't show you, but we'll get into a little bit later, but we can compare models as the design is progressing. So every time we get a new model, we can perform a change analysis on it and determine what's changed. If we, during that 2-week period where we updated models, we discussed these cost options to, reduce the amount of skin or reduce the amount of glass on something, we can verify that was getting put into the model and then that the design is progressing the way that it was intended. So the quantity harvesting, basically the extraction of the quantities, the scope items from the model, as well as doing system analysis. So this is kind of the information that's provided from Reddit. This is basically your items that are included, how they're labeled. This was just an example of how they were labeled when they came over from Reddit into a symbol. And then we were able to go in and recategorize these. I didn't get a whole lot of detail in there, but sorted by our bid item and cost code. So now everything that shows up as 03A foundations, we've got our helping bit of walls, you know, some, I guess, some unsigned items, as well as some stairs outside, as well as the flat work. So you've got all of these items that are, you know, how we price within our system. Talked about this is, you know, the trade partner, but budgeting, you know, doing the visuals and export information, quick updates. They're side by side kind of visual. This was a project I was working on where it was going through the ceiling types, and you know, everything's color coded and it matches up with the Excel sheet, so they can kind of see where it's at if they, you know, they know, like, for example, the siding area, the light blue area is, you know, that's a two-story area open to below, so they know they may have to need a lift in there to install that ceiling. And then the change analysis. So this is comparing earlier versions to, you know, make sure that the design is continuing as intended. An example here, this is a visual representation of it. So when we do a change analysis in Sentinel, you know, it's color coded by, you know, anything green is added, anything red is, you know, been removed from the model, from the earlier model. And then the remaining three are either a type change, quantity change, or both. So as you can kind of see on here, this was an example of an addition that was done on the high school. Originally, they had a penthouse on the high school, and we value engineered that down to just doing a mechanical screen around the rooftop unit. So you can see that by the red that the penthouse was removed from the project, and then they added mechanical screens. So we were able to validate that they were implementing the changes that we were comparing or providing. Then the model comparison. So this is the quantity representation of that. So it gives you, as everything's categorized, we can continue to evaluate, you know, anything red was a decreasing quantity, anything green, obviously increasing quantity, so we can verify where we were going as far as quantity wise. We just gotta remember, it's not easy, but we can't just take the quantities in line with it. As we alluded to earlier, there's always things that we're going to have to be double checking. We're going to have to make sure that we evaluate the entire project. So here's kind of an example of some limited information, you know, in varying models, in various models. So at an early stage of, you know, this was an SD model from February 20th, 2018 on our high school. These were all wall types. As you can see on the left-hand side, there's maybe 10, 12 different types of wall in this model at that point in time. Fast forward to September 10th of 2018, we're nearing, I think this was maybe a 50% CD model. As you can see, there's, you know, quite a few more different wall types over there, and I'm not even showing any of all of them because you can still scroll down. But you know, it just gets more and more information in there that we're able to dive in and get more exact pricing.
And I can talk to that too. I mean, you probably know too that, you know, as a designer, you're just trying to get the spaces and everything figured out. So you're just using a generic interior wall that's roughly 4.5 inches thick. And obviously, as the design progresses towards CD, then you're deciding which fire ratings are needed on the walls. If there's, you know, two layers of JIP, if it's going to be 1/2 inch or 5/8 JIP, and that's what changes all these wall types to 4, 5, 6, 6.1, and so that's where those wall types come in. And you get more information, and you know it's two layers of JIP or how thick the JIP is.
And it's probably hard to read, but you know these actually have their wall types actually have wall tax designations on them. So you can go back to the wall schedule on the two plans again and verify everything that's provided on them.
And actually, this is what I was talking about, the kind of levels of development of a model. You know, as you're initially designing, it's just a generic wall, zero layer information to it. But as you progress through to kind of a construction document phase, it's moving along that levels of development so that you're getting more refined information. And of course, in this example, this is where, as it progresses, you're getting more toward that clash detection and fabrication model where you're getting information on bolts and connections and things like that you can really use, at least in the clash detection area. But you're getting more estimating knowledge too as that model.
And I think this is collaborative with the design team as well, because you can can kind of steer them, and they'll take it. I mean, we don't need, you know, down to the, you know, the exact size of a toilet partition per se, but we're more interested in the size of a footing. So you can kind of steer where they're spending their time to help us, so they can continue working on the things that are important to finish the design before, you know, before getting into the details of items that aren't as important.
And you can use this level of development table that comes from the BIM form, which is kind of a collaboration between the AEC and AIA, to try and get to those established definitions of what a model element should be and where it should be along in a process. And as Ashley says, he may not need certain information on floors. He might just need to know what the perimeter is, but later as he goes on, he might need to know the finishes and baseboards and things like that, and can start to use that table to, especially if you're involved early on.
Here was just an example of, you know, it not being the easy button, so you got to watch out for good items. This was looking at a later stage, that's why I isolated the visual representation as all the flooring in the project, and it was at a later stage, and I noticed I was comparing quantities, and I was like, my epoxy flooring more than doubled. So the epoxy flooring represents item that is in all the science classrooms. Well, I got to looking at it, dived in a little deeper. Tell that there's two layers of red there. So they had redrawn the red or the epoxy flooring without deleting the previous one. So he was able to identify that and, you know, correct it before it got too late.
And I had earlier said, you know, you could cheat the model to get the result you want, but it's also just understanding how the model works too. So if we look at this ceiling, you draw ceiling lights often, or diffusers if you're drawing them in, or parametrically hosted, so when you pop them into the ceiling, that actually takes away the square footage of that ceiling. So a ceiling that's 637 square feet, once you pop in all these lights, you're down to 565 square feet. So if you're estimating just from the number that comes out of that ceiling, you're getting kind of a deflated value of how much square footage that is. So then you need to know, well, maybe I either need to delete the lights wholesale or take the perimeter, or look deeper into the data, you know, in terms of the area that is on that ceiling.
And, I mean, that's just ceilings. I mean, drywall, walls, they don't take out doors and windows, like already what kind of mounts. You've got to be cognizant of that. And actually, Assemble's been great on that. I don't know if they, I mean, we requested them to include the gross square foot as an option, as an opportunity to provide an output. So they went ahead and implemented that because we were running into that. Example of that is an exterior curb wall where we just counted like the glass panes. You know, we were missing all the framing and everything, but that's not how it comes out as a price on an earlier stage.
Same thing goes with interior walls too. As an architect, I would just draw all the walls for the deck, and I'll have the two layers of jib on that, but I'm not going to necessarily take the time to stop that jib above a ceiling. You can draw a stacked wall that shows just stud layer above a ceiling. So you get an inflated value of sheetrock or gypsum, you know, you took off just by the numbers that come out of the model. And of course, that's not even how you might even estimate, you know, gypsum board anyway. You do sheets and waste and all of that too, so you have to know what kind of numbers you want out of the model and not just take it for granted.
So there's obviously some other uses for outside of estimating. So as I kind of alluded to earlier, the trade partner, getting budgeting, but we could also do like a scope review. After, you know, projects have been out to bid, we can sit down and, you know, kind of walk through the model with them and, you know, make sure everything is included on both sides. You know, do some progress tracking, you know, in the field during coordination meetings, or even the scheduling meetings, we can, you know, kind of track where everything is, as well as doing phasing diagrams, you know, for either doing a visual representation of that. We've actually used this in an instance for our client. You know, it was a multi-phase project, and it was good to see, show, you know, he was more of a visual learner. We could show him what we were doing at each stage in the process. And then do a change order analysis and pricing on that. So we can validate our trade partners' pricing by quantities as well. One pitfall of that is it requires the model to be continuously updated, which a lot of times, they don't, but they may not do that after the CD document phase. It's hard to read, but there's a YouTube site out there for Assemble Systems, which shows tons of cut videos and what I put together here today. So if you're interested in looking at it, I can share that site with you. So here's kind of, you know, what we call the aha moment. So you catch something, you know, that you might not have ever caught before. This was a very early rendition. Basically, this was the first set of drawings. It was the one page, you know, hey, I need a quick budget on this building. I've got one floor plan and that is it. Well, we were trying to identify, you know, roof lines and, you know, where, you know, heights of walls and all that. And it really doesn't show you much there, obviously, as you can see, trying to validate with how tall the walls are and whatnot. Because we knew part of it was warehousing, we knew part of it was the kitchens. So when we, you know, plugged in the model, that they gave us a model because they designed it for that, we could actually identify, you know, hey, here, this area of the roof is much higher, so obviously the walls are going to be, we're going to figure out how square footage are there. It's hard to see, but we can see kind of there in the front here. This was going back to that earlier model. That's all precast, so we identified that that is a storm shelter. That it was all precast interior storm shelter. So it was just able to, you know, pick up some of the things that we wouldn't normally get from a 2D representation.
That's what I was saying earlier too, is you don't even have to estimate from the model. Just if you can gain access to a model just for visualization purposes, it'll just help you understand that early set or even that final set better, rather than trying to, you know, we're all seasoned contractors, we can kind of figure out how that goes together. You can see it, it's just, you know, on to the next decision right away. I think this is mine. Filling in for Scott. Scott, this is another instance, I think, of just early SD plan where there's not a lot of information, but again, gaining access to that model. There was information in there that wasn't provided in the sheets that we were able to learn more about. You can even see, I think there's CAD,
yeah, I mean,
furniture plans.
You can see kind of the wire and stuff that's not going to show up on a plan. But we can see it as, well, we're going to need some cabinetry in there, so on and so forth. Sorry, we can that'll get there.
This one, Ashley and I actually worked together on office building early on. You can see there's a large meeting room there. But there were lots of large meeting rooms in there. This was really early on. So if you looked at the Revit schedule, just a large meeting room, large meeting room, large meeting room. So gaining access to that Revit model, we were able to then just put our own design and almost accelerate the design a little bit for our own needs just to gain information out of it. So again, that was a static sheet that was PDF'd out, but once you click on it and make it live, you're basically looking into that live model. So we're clicking on the meeting rooms right now and gaining the information on the browser there on how much square footage they are. But if we go ahead and just add a schedule like an architect would, and I think we're making a room schedule here. Mm-hmm. So we're making a room schedule, hitting OK, we're adding a few parameters like area, we're adding name, and we're adding a number, and a perimeter, and hitting OK. And so there is, we also added a color overlay to the plan as well now. So there's that large meeting room now. Now it has a room number 435, and it has 1,119 square feet. So now Ashley can start to look at okay, you know, is this room going to be carpeted or is it going to be hardwood floor? Now he's got more square footage on all the bathrooms to know about the tile and things like that. He can start to make more assumptions on quantities and their costs.
Quicker rather than going through and doing the takeoffs. They just sped up the process.
You're doing that right in Revit?
Right in Revit. So that would be a case where you get access to the Revit model. Again, it's that sharing, you know, the sharing going on between the design team and the contractor, you can add that information.
But you can do similar product or systems within a simple.
This, if you've been out there to the Prairie Fire Museum in Overland Park, the steel on this, we don't have an image of it, but this diachromatic glass and metal, one, the steel structure was crazy, so if you could just see the steel structure, it even helped in construction to be able to look at the steel shops, but then look at the 3D model and go, how are you going to hang that beam or that column that wasn't really a beam or a column, it was diagonal. But then almost, we got an unfolded elevation of this entire kind of articulating glass wall eventually. But we also had a 3D model that we just threw into SketchUp and you could just click on square footages, and rather than trying to divide all this glass in the middle into triangles and squares to, you know, do proper estimating, you could just click on the surface of, say, like just that purple one, you know, like that purple glass is different from this clear glass, and so it's a lot more expensive actually.
And like what he alluded to with it not being on any single plane, and we were not getting a, you know, laid out flat version of it until later in, we were able to accurately get, you know, square footages, because if you take a, you know, square footage off of an angle, obviously you're going to miss something because of the, you know, distance back versus to the left.
And then that obviously just leads into down the road. Ashley and his team are really the first ones to kind of gain access to this model and pull information out of it. And I mean, you're looking at just section cuts through models in the upper left, you're looking at clash detection on the upper right, time schedule to the model in the lower left, and then just a really just a SketchUp model sequence. But this is really just the first stage of how we use this model throughout construction and either pull information out of it or gain information from it. Any questions? Questions on estimating from a model or using one? Or?
How friendly is the Symbol program to learn from the ground up? Is it something you recommend taking further, like online classes to learn how, or is it something you can jump into pretty comfortably? Like, and then for me personally, like I have a CAD, I can use CAD, so is it going to be fairly intuitive? Or
I haven't taken any classes on it. It's just, you know, it was fairly intuitive to learn, in my opinion. And the website I alluded to, the YouTube, so they've got basically a video out there for almost anything you want to do. It's a short 2 to 5 minute video that you can watch, and it picks up pretty, pick it up pretty easy.
Okay. I think it's fairly intuitive too. I think a lot of the programs we're using now are fairly intuitive. You know, there's a lot. You can even look at the, I think there's an Assemble app too, so you can look at the stuff on here if you need to. It's almost that these programs now are so intuitive and simply you can start hitting buttons. That's why we put the No Easy button up there. It's almost more of we're running into the problem as an industry. I think we've got to make sure know how to build a building and know how to estimate and learn those basics and how to actually think about how long it takes to put in a concrete sidewalk and not just have the schedule tied to the model or use P6 or whatever. You can use Microsoft Project pretty intuitively if you start to use it, but actually knowing the knowledge behind it is the big thing. That it's almost more of our training efforts internal than so much the software.
Yeah, garbage in, garbage out.
Yeah.
And even with your knowledge within the, you know, with knowing how to use CAD, that gives you a leg up because you're seeing, you know what you're seeing when you get the Revit model.
Thank you.
What's the advantage of Revit? What's the advantage of Assemble over just using Revit?
I would say it's probably licensing more than anything. I mean, we really don't even, you use Revit to import it into Assemble.
Okay.
And then I think there's another one with it being cloud-based, so that's something we didn't mention. Assemble is cloud-based. I could pick it up here, I could go down the street, as long as I've got a Wi-Fi connection, we can open up a model and look at it. As you mentioned, we can open up a model on my phone if we need to and spin it around.
So it's cloud-based?
Yep.
I think Andy's actually going to talk about some cloud-based stuff after this one, too. And Revit actually is not as intuitive as Assemble. It's a big, giant program.
Yeah.
You can definitely get into it.
So what's the computing requirements for like Assemble?
That's nothing. The Revit computer computing program is a lot bigger because you've got a 300 megabyte file in there sometimes. Again, all that, you're basically just taking that Revit model, shooting it up to the cloud, and then accessing it through a web portal and adding your information to it there. So Assemble or another cloud-based software is where most of the industry
have. As we progress in the coordination process, we make few changes in the model. So is there a way to sync the latest model with the work that we have done?
Sync the latest quantities?
Let's suppose if we have made some changes in the model, so is there a way to sync the latest model with the
So it was kind of what I was moving to on the change analysis. So anytime we get a new model, we basically load it into the system, and then it keeps the number of versions. Like on one of these models, I had up to 18 versions because I've been working on it for a while, and it's in a model like every 2 weeks. I'd not do a change analysis, and it actually, or as soon as you loaded it in, it automatically updated the model into the program, and then I could. Change analysis was showing what had changed from that model from the last model. We could identify exactly what was modified.
Did it move your information over though?
Yes.
Yeah, you could update hourly if you wanted to, you know, in terms of or daily or you know by your override the last version, you can go back to the last version to see where you can compare an early version and a late version if you wanted to. So all that information is overridden. There for your access.
So you asked if it updated
your changed parameters and stuff.
Right. So as long as it wasn't a new item, right. It carried it over. Now, so I went in there and I categorized everything and put it in our parameters. You know, for a very first step, it might take you know a day or two to get that all set up. But then each additional model, you know, cut that time down maybe half hour, two hours, depending on the amount of changes. So I mean, you still have to categorize and carry your parameters over for any new items, but anything that was already there, if it was a quantity change or a type change, it carried that through.
And again, our information isn't staying as simple. We're then taking it out into Excel or through a bridge to Sage and Timberline to get into our actual big estimating software. So some of the almost another bridge to get the information where we want it to.
From an MEP's perspective, are you seeing electrical models really, are they still using more of a 2D kind of version for a lot of this, from your engineers?
So they're coming in not as soon. I usually won't see my first MEP model until you know, midway through the DD phase is when we'll start seeing them, and then they're less. They don't update them as often, obviously, because they're, you know, change ceilings half a dozen times. Well, they're not going to update lighting layout every time that the chief of ceiling complaint has changed or something. But we are seeing them, and they're coming in a little bit later. So for instance, that model where I had 18 versions, I might have had 4 versions of the MVP model.
But you are getting a lot more line diagrams that represent lengths of conduit and where they're going.
It's not as detailed, probably.
It's not as detailed in terms of, you know, there's more information from lights and fixtures like that.
It's more fixture count and stuff like that. You know, on some of our mechanical items, we will get ductwork layout and stuff like that.
It's definitely something to keep track of, though, because, you know, Revit did start as an architectural tool, and the MEP side was not as great, but that has developed more and more. So even if you're not using it now, at least you know where it's going. Yeah.
Is there a way to customize waste factors, say concrete? Is that something you can build into your program, or is that something that you can adjust on your end?
Yeah, I mean, you can put as much data into that, you know, you can put your own line items in there and write your own code. So if you could figure out a way to.
I believe there is. I mean, I haven't delved into it yet. We started using Assemble a little over a year ago, so I'm touching the surface of what you can do. But I have seen you know webinars where they actually go through and they're adding waste factors into two items. So yeah.
So you could add however you could structure it, you could probably get some information out of it.
I think just as a general comment, not so much a question, but I've talked to some of the folks over at Assemble. We haven't made that step yet, but to anyone else, they're very accommodating. They'll give you a test drive of it, so they'll either let you bring in your own models if you have them, or they'll give you something to play around with. They were very helpful. Again, we haven't made that step, but also to your point, it's garbage in, garbage out, so if the designers aren't giving you all that detail, you really do still need the plans or an understanding of what, say, the finish schedules are, things like that, because they may not always be putting that information in there. So.
We took a pretty methodical approach to talk to them for years, you know, just about their product, but we did estimate it. Now this was quantification for a while, which is a little bit more, maybe more steps, you know, a little bit more tedious, but it was to make sure, you know, people like actually knowing how the model worked and what we were getting out of it before, because you can, we've heard stories too of using Assemble or other programs, and, you know, it's a pretty easy button. If you're pressed for time and you gotta get something out, you could get burned by it, so it's really knowing that,
the level of detail that's included. And I think that's a good point. You know, early on at an SD level, I'm using them more for areas and stuff like that. I'm still looking at 2D plans to get finishes and wall types and stuff like that. But one, you know, as it progresses, it's, you can rely a little bit more and more on the model. You know. But it's always, you gotta have that open conversation with the design team to make sure that, you know, they know what you're using it for as well as so they can, you know, alert you to, well, that's not going to be right, so please don't do it.
And figuring out how it works for you too, because obviously there's still a lot of drawing that happens on top of a model also in terms of, you know.
So is this your primary takeoff tool now?
Yes, it is.
Pardon?
It is for me.
Okay.
Yep. Are you using on-screen takeoff or?
I use OSD, again, at the SD level, so it, I start with OST and Assemble, and then, you know, OST kind of goes
away at some point
as the design progresses.
Are you saving time by that process, though? I mean, is it helping?
Yes, very much so. I mean, because it's pretty quick, but rather than, you know, taking on, I can identify all the similar items, and it automatically calculates. But again, you got to investigate it.
Especially saving time too when you get those iterative estimates too, where you're getting models, you know, more often. You're not going to reinvent the wheel necessarily.
Yeah, you don't have to go in and retake off all the walls continuously. You can just look at what has changed.
Is there any concern? I don't have a lot of understanding really with you know, the modeling aspect on the design side. Is there any concern when you put up the LODs for the models that say the engineers only have a contract with the client to go to a, you know, a 300 or maybe even a 400 LOD, that you don't get that really granular level? Or is it just by nature that the design will go to that highest level of, you know, it's a 400 in the LOD, so you really get all that data? Is that something that we need to be concerned about as an estimator? What LOD are they defining?
I mean, yes, I would agree that that is a concern, but it goes back to, you know, having a conversation, knowing what you're going to get.
I mean, it's not an easy button, right?
Right. You know, I know early on, a lot of design teams were very hesitant to give out their models because they didn't realize what we were using them for. You know, they're like, well, I don't want you to just take that run. You just got to explain to them, this is what we're looking for. We're still going to validate things, but you tell us what we can rely on and what we can't, and, you know, we'll do the rest. It helps us speed up the process. Because they're under crunch. They're looking for a quick turnaround to make sure that what they're designing is staying on budget. So the quicker we can turn them around, it helps them. That way they're not wasting their time designing something they're not in the back.